Good morning. Good morning and welcome to worship this day. What a wondrous day we've been given to come together. So let us come, let us have the Holy Spirit fill us and bind us, and let us in this time and moment make a joyful noise to the Lord. Let us worship.
Would you please stand for the call to worship? Wake up, no more dozing off.
The time is now.
The kingdom is almost here.
There are songs to be sung.
Chains to be broken.
Children to be loved.
Hungry to be fed.
It's time to come alive.
We are somebody.
God's people.
Empowered and blessed.
Called and sent.
Wake up.
Sing, pray, love.
Remain standing, please, for hymn number 96, Praise the Lord Who Reigns Above.
Thank you.
you join me in the opening prayer? Gracious God, you call each of us to carry out your mission of love to the world. As we rededicate ourselves to your service this morning, guide us in the direction you desire us to walk. Teach us and lead us forever and everywhere to be alive and on fire with songs of gratitude, words of witness, prayers of compassion, deeds of justice, acts of kindness. Holy God, draw us close in our time together and fill us with your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. I'll invite up our young disciples for our young disciples' time. Good morning, guys. How are you? All right. So this morning I was thinking, what am I going to do? What am I going to do this morning? So I went down to our storage room. I grabbed our trusty flashlight because I haven't replaced some bulbs. I just haven't gotten around to it. And so I was going to look for something. And I went down there and I flicked it on and look what happened. You see anything? Neither did I. So I shake it. I'm like, do you hear the battery? But what do you think the problem is? You know, it wasn't the bulb, so I unscrewed it, because that's what you do, right? Well, the batteries could be in backwards, and that's something I've done, yes. But you know what? There was only one. And how many does it take? Two. Now let's hope this works, right? Or else this ain't going nowhere fast. So I put that in. I went upstairs. Oh, look at and there was light. So what did it need? Yeah, because what is the flashlight made for? Light, right, yeah, because why else would you grab it, right? You wouldn't grab it for any other reason. Yeah, because it needs to have this battery. It needed to have this power, right? And so I was thinking about us, because what are we made to do? What are we made to do, do you think? Why did God make us? What are we to do? To help other people. Could it be to be lights? Do you think so? Yeah, but what do we need to do that? Just like this little battery, what do we, or just like this flashlight, what do we need? What is our battery? What's love, God, prayer, study, right? We need this power that comes from outside of us to be put in us that we may be lights for the world, right? Because are we meant to just sit on a shelf? Are we meant to be dark? We are meant to be lights of God's love and hope. So I want you to remember that. Next time you grab a flashlight, think about that battery. Think about the battery of God's love that's being put in your heart. Okay? Let's say a prayer. Oh, God, thank you for these young disciples. Thank you for their light that they shine. Thank you for all the work that they do to share your love in little ways and in big ways. Be with them. Keep them safe. Guide them over this next week. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So as they leave, let's stand, share the peace of Christ with one another. Good morning, Elmo. What? Oh, you gotta be kidding me. Not to say good morning. Not to say I love you. You want this, the church one, right? Thank you.
The New Testament lesson this morning is from the book of James, chapter 2, verses 14 through 18. And it was particularly appropriate for this reader because I've struggled over the years with the connection between faith and good deeds, and this spells it out fairly clearly. My brothers, what use is it for a man to say he has faith when he does nothing to show for it? Can that faith save him? Suppose a brother or a sister is in rags with not enough food for the day, and one of you says, good luck to you. Keep yourselves warm, have plenty to eat, but does nothing to supply their bodily needs. What is the good of that? So with faith, if it does not lead to action, it is in itself a lifeless thing. But someone may object. Here is one who claims to have faith, and another who points to his deeds, to which I reply, prove it to me that this faith you speak of is real, though not accompanied by deeds. And by deeds, I will prove to you my faith.
Our gospel lesson this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew 25, those selected verses there that are printed in your bulletin. I invite you to stand for our reading of our gospel lesson. Hear these words from Matthew. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. May God add his blessing to our hearing and living out of the word this day. You may be seated. I'd like to begin this morning with a short little quiz. You just do right there in your seats to yourself. As you're sitting there this morning, I'd like you to think to yourself in rank order from number one to maybe number five, the wealthiest people in the world. So from number one to five. Or rank in your head from one to five, because I'm sure you got that one, right? The last five Heisman Trophy winners that there's been. Or how about the last five winners of the Miss America contest? Or how about the last half dozen Academy Award winners for Best Actor or Best Picture over the past 5 years? Do you have their faces in your heads? How about the last 5 years worth of World Series winners? Now, somebody might actually get that one. If you do, tell me. But most of all, how do you do with questions like that? We struggle. We draw blanks. We're like, oh, I don't know. I can't even remember what I ate for dinner 2 nights ago. But how about these questions? Name 3 teachers who aided your journey through school. 3 teachers that made an impression on you. Or how about name 3 friends? 3 friends who helped you through a difficult time. Or what about 3 people who taught you something worthwhile in your life that you still learn today, that still inspired you to this day? Or how about 3 people who've made you feel appreciated and made you feel special? Now that one's a little easier, isn't it? Those faces, those names, those pop into our heads. Because it's amazing how the people who make a difference, who affect us the most in our lives, are not the ones with the most money or the credentials or the awards. No, they're the ones who take the time to care, who get up close to us and we are in relationship with. And they are, for the most part, ordinary people who took the time to reach out and to care. So today we're going to look at how we reach out, at how if we want a growing faith, we need to have a balance in our relationship with God and our relationship with others. Today we finish looking at the life of John Wesley. Remembering we're not looking at John Wesley because he's a perfect person, not because he is a saint, but he is a man who in beginning a revival that changed the world has some lessons for us on our spiritual journey. So last week we looked at grace, how in realizing that we don't have to earn God's love, what we need to do is accept that God already loves us. It was this realization that transformed John. And last We looked at this picture. Do you remember that car? Remember that? The car on the left is that car in the junkyard, right? And somebody walked by and they saw that car and they didn't see a car that was all junked up. They said, I see a thing of beauty. And they took it back to their shop and they worked and they worked and they worked. And the car on the bottom right is that GTO 1965. That's the same car, restored. And so we talked how grace received into our hearts as we surrender to Jesus transforms us from the inside out, setting us free, giving us new life. But there was more, because that's only half the gospel. For God is working to restore us and renew us, not just for us, but for the world around us. And this renewal doesn't happen overnight, but it happens on a journey where each and every day we get up and we follow in the footsteps of Jesus, where we grow in our personal holiness, as Wesley called it, where we do things like worship together and take communion, and we have Bible study, and we have prayer that brings us close to God. But we also grow in our social holiness, where we see the needs of the world, the brokenness that is around us, and we step in to do something. We reach out to be the hands and the feet and the heart of God, understanding that the way that God works in our world, the way God moves in our world, is to restore people and then send them as instruments of healing and hope. We have been saved, if you want to think of it with the car, we've been salvaged, we've been transformed, so that we can be instruments of reconciliation and redemption and healing in our world. Because you see, there are two sides to the gospel. And the danger is when one side is overemphasized. So the one side is where we focus on our personal relationship with Jesus and getting to heaven, to the exclusion of forgetting that God cares about this world and that we have been called and sent to care for the needs that are surrounding us. We need to see and respond to the homelessness and the poverty and the harshness of life around it. That we are not just to pray for God's kingdom to come, but we're to take steps to achieve it. For our faith is the source of power to transform our world. So that's the one side of it. The other side is where we do all sorts of good things, and then we dismiss having a vital relationship with Jesus Christ. And we think just doing all the good things is enough. That's where we stop. If all we ever do is good things, but we never surrender our lives to God, we are missing out on the power and on the presence found in our faith and our daily walk with Christ that transforms us from the inside out and moves us to reach out. Doing good without an active faith life is like driving your car without ever filling up on gas. So if you leave today and you just get in the car and you say, I'm going to drive to California, and you just drive to California and you never once stop for gas ever, sooner or later, I promise you, try it if you don't believe me, your car will stop. Without an active, vital faith life filling us, we lose our focus. We lose our drive. We lose our energy. As our world shrinks, as the events and the busyness of our lives just take over and push everything out. And so we are called to balance these two sides, the personal and the social gospel, our faith and our works. For John Wesley, faith and works were two sides of the same coin. Growing in our faith, growing deeper and closer to God, would lead to growing closer to our neighbors and our community and our world, because our eyes and hearts and hands are already open to the needs of others. As we heard in our reading that Glenn read, what good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but you do not have works? Can faith save you? If your brother and sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says, go in peace, keep warm and eat your fill, and yet you do nothing to supply their bodily needs, what good is that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. And so we need to hear this day that no matter who you are sitting here today, no matter who you are, no matter what you're going through, no matter how old you are, God is still working in your life. John Wesley understood that faith isn't an inward directive, contemplative life. Faith goes outside to live and to play. For John Wesley, this got worked out with the Kingswood miners. We heard last week how he went to the Kingswood mining town to preach of grace, this town in southwest England that was a hard and a harsh place where the miners worked. There was no church there, no clergy had ever visited, except for John Wesley, who went and on a hillside preached to the crowds about God's grace, about God's love for these miners who felt forgotten about, but he said to them, God knows your names, and God knows your struggles, and God calls you to be his own. Now, John could have just stopped there and gone back to his comfortable life in Bristol or in London, but he didn't stop there. He didn't just preach about God's love and leave, he stayed. This, and I want you to imagine, John Wesley, a very prim, a very proper Oxford graduate, an Anglican priest, who has absolutely nothing in common with these dirty and these rough and these hardworking and these rough-speaking miners, went and stayed with them to make God's love real, to bring redemption and hope. So he writes some friends who come and they begin a school. He starts a school there for them, for all the kids to learn how to read and write and learn. And after beginning that, he went on to provide other support. And after leaving Kingswood, John Wesley went back to London and he founded a religious society known as the Foundry that changed the very shape of London. In a time when the poor and prisoners and widows were just left to fend for themselves, he worked tirelessly for the lives of these people. He gave them small loans, similar to our Kiva fund that our outreach group does, of micro-lending. At a time when medical care was non-existent, he provided medical care. He provided widows and orphans with clean and safe lodging, and of course, he started a school. All of this Wesley did because of the presence and the power of God working in his life. You see, for John Wesley and for us today, Scripture and faith make no sense without working for the kingdom of God. In our gospel lesson, we hear how Jesus calls those to enter his kingdom. He says, come inherit the kingdom, for I was hungry and you gave me food, thirsty and you gave me something to drink, a stranger and you welcomed me. And of course, those who are listening say, well, where did we see you? I didn't see you. Where did we see you, Lord? And Jesus says, just as you did it to the least of these, you did it to me. This was a piece of scripture that Wesley had memorized and lived out his life, and I want to encourage you to do the same thing. For when we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, that's not just a prayer. That's a call to action. And this doesn't have to be in any dramatic way. In 2009, Bea Salazar had undergone back surgery, and she was on disability. She was depressed, and she's just trying to get through each day, which is a real struggle for her. So one afternoon, she goes to put the trash out, and she notices this little boy, and he's out there, and he's digging in the dumpster. And she realizes this little boy is digging in the dumpster because he's hungry, and he's looking for food. So she takes him inside her home, and she sits him down, and she gives him a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, and she sends him home. 15 minutes later, there's a knock at the door, and she opens it to find six kids that are standing there. And they all say to her, is it true that you're the lady giving away the peanut butter and jelly sandwiches? So what do you say? You have six hungry kids on your doorstep. So the next day, she thought, well, that was good. That was a nice day. I fed this little boy. I fed six of his little friends he found on the streets. The next day, even more kids showed up. And then more arrived the day after that. And when school began, kids came and they said, you know, you seem like a really smart lady. Could you help me with my homework? Well, then B said, well, holy cow, I need some help. So then she got some volunteers and some supplies, and her landlord even donated an apartment, and soon she had 100 children coming every single day. And 10 years later, five of these kids had begun community college. And she later reflected that those kids pulled me out of myself. There was a point when I stopped thinking about my own pain, and I started concentrating on somebody else's. It's true that when you help others, you help yourself. Who would have thought that making one peanut butter and jelly sandwich would grow into something that would affect so many lives, especially mine? Sometimes, and this is the point for today, if you hear nothing else, you know, you're focused on lunch, if you hear nothing else, hear this. Sometimes, making a sandwich and feeding a hungry child is more than it seems. Because it's about bringing about the kingdom of God, because it is about feeding and noticing Jesus Christ in our midst. It is saying, here I am, Lord. Here I am. Send me. And so today, let us hold together both gospels, our faith and our work, the social gospel and the personal gospel, as we realize and recognize God at work in our lives, calling us to be more than we are. Paul states in Ephesians, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of work, so that no one may boast. For we are what God has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand." And that phrase, "made us," originally translated, translates into God's handiwork. So this would read, we have been saved by grace, not by our works, but we have been saved to be God's handiwork. Isn't that wonderful? To be God's handiwork, God's heart, God's hands, redeeming the world, because this is our way of life. Our way of life where we love God with all our heart and mind and soul and strength, and we love our neighbor as we love ourselves. This is the way of the kingdom. This is the center of faith and the heart of faith we're called to walk. So Wesley summarized this for himself and for those that came to be called Methodists, and he did it in typical Wesley fashion, very methodical. He came up with three rules they wanted to remember. He called them the general rules. And this is what it was. He said, you know what? As you go forward, I want you to do no harm. I want you to avoid evil. And I want you to do all the good that you can. And I want you to stay in love with God. Those are the three rules. Those are the three general rules. Do no harm, avoid evil, do good, and stay in love with God. But the way that works is when you do no harm and you avoid evil, that then opens you up to then do good to other people. And as you're doing good, then that's what helps you stay in love with God. But as you're staying in love with God and reflecting on your relationship with God, well, that opens your eyes to, like, wow, I really hurt somebody, or I've really left this undone. And so that leads you to do more, do no harm. And as you're doing that, then that leads you to reflect deeper, like, oh, well, I could reach out here. And so you start doing good, which then leads you to grow closer and more in love with God, which then leads you to do even less harm and do even more good. And do you see? It's a pattern. It's a pattern of your life. It's a pattern and a way of life. This is what Wesley did, to finish the story of Wesley. Wesley went on to preach and minister for 52 years, and he traveled 250,000 miles on horseback or walking. And in his life, he preached 40,000 sermons, and the majority of them were never in a church. They were outdoors. And he preached in the rain, and he preached on side of roads, and why would he do that? Because of this, filled with the grace and the love of God, to reach out to others and share it. So let us go forth this day, reminding ourselves, as you get up in the morning, first of all, remind yourself of those, but as you go about your day, as you're driving around, as you're meeting with other people, as you're watching the news, as you're taking a walk, reflect on, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Let that be more than a prayer. Let that be our call to action. And may it be so in our lives every day. God be with you, and God fill you, and may you share God's love with the world. Amen. Let's stand. Let's sing in the faith we sing. 2190, bring forth the kingdom. Amen. Be seated. Let's turn to our prayer time with our joys and our concerns. And so what joys or concerns do you bring this day to lift in prayer? Yes. Oh. Prayers for your cousin who just gave birth. So prayers for her and prayers for the new little one. Other joys, concerns? Yeah, Ken? Well, welcome. It's great to have you here. Other joys or concerns this morning? Yeah, Wendy? So for the boy's grandfather, inducted into the Hall of Fame. All right, at Homestead. Great. Yeah, Ross? So continue prayers for Hayden, who was the victim of a very violent crime, and for all those involved, and continued healing with this. Thank you. Any other prayers? Yeah. We had a wonderful time at our outdoor worship, and we were blessed with two sandhill cranes that flew over. So everybody said, you know, sometimes you get the blue angels. Well, you know, we had the sandhill cranes. Beat that, blue angels. Second time. Penny, did you? Yeah. So prayers for Ethan, who's got some stomach issues and going in for testing, and then prayers for Ella, little Ella that we've been praying for, born with a lot of difficulties, who's going to be adopted and have a stable family, and so that's good. Any other joys or concerns? Well, oh yeah, Ellen? All right. So if the kid's on the road doing good and the kid's traveling, we pray for them. Yeah, Ginger? All right. Let us pray for all the kids, all the children of our world, no matter what they're facing. Well, speaking of kids, it's a good segue. Thank you, Ginger. Because one of our joys of our church is our daycare and our preschool, known as Sunlight Child Development Center. Do you know it's celebrated its sixth birthday? Did you know that? And so we have regularly heard updates from Sunlight, and so I included this in the prayer time, not only so we continue to pray for Sunlight, but because it is a joy. So I want to invite up Sue Lyon, our director, and she's going to say a little bit, and Ed too, if you want to come up too. And then we're going to see life at Sunlight, right? So come on up, Sue and Ed.
Okay, hello. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Sue Lyon. I am the director at Sunlight Center. We are a ministry of Mequon United Methodist Church. As Tim said, we have just celebrated our sixth anniversary. We could not have succeeded without the help we have received to date from MUMC. We have 32 children enrolled at this time, and in the last 3 weeks, we have enrolled 4 new children. Hazel Zimmer is a 2-year-old and is in our Fishies 2K program. Natalie, who is a special needs baby, just started in our Cubby's infant room a week ago. We will be working with her physical therapist to give her the care and the therapy that she needs. We have a 3-year-old boy named Bastion that will start in our Bunnies 3K program this Monday. Bastion does not speak any English at this time, but we have had a few non-English speaking children in the past, and it's amazing how quickly they pick up the English language from their classmates. We also have a new little boy who's 18 months old beginning in the doggies toddler room on Monday. All of these children have come to us from word of mouth and our wonderful website. Sunlight has grown to be what we believe to be one of the best childcare centers in the area. Please sit back and relax while you watch a short slideshow showing some of the fun activities and special programs that Sunlight has provided for all of our amazing children this past year.
Jesus loves the little children of the world. ushers in the pews and out in the narthex, and I think all of us probably know someone. Might be through your grandkids who know someone else that has a young family that may now and in the future have a need for the excellent services that Sunlight provides. And so I encourage you to give us a hand. At networking, and along with our website, has been our main sources of growth that we've had. And there's one more slide. But the second thing I wanted to mention today is that next month in October, the final transfer will be made to repay all the advances that were made to start Sunlight 6 years ago. And so I, along with Doug, will no longer have to do those bank transfers to repay that debt. It'll be done and behind us. So that is truly a joy. And lastly, again, thanks to everyone here for all the support over those 6 years. It took a lot of hands and a lot of work to bring this ministry to where it is today, but it's truly a joy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ed. Thank you, Sue. Thank you to everybody who makes this ministry real, that reaches out to all these kids. And there's an article in the Spire about Sunlight, but in the past 6 years, 114 kids have come through Sunlight. That's a lot of little kids. That's a lot of families that we as a church, you don't see them, but they're there. And those are lives that we are touching with this ministry. So thank you. We may not say that enough in this church, but thank you. Thank you for what you've done, for your prayers, for your support to keep this ministry vital and growing and reaching out. So, thank you. Any other prayers? That's a great joy to share of Sunlight, but any other prayers, any other joys or any other concerns that you... All right, well, with all these, let's pause, let's pray. Oh God, we gather this morning, and we are truly blessed and very thankful to come to this time, to this place, where we know you are working in our lives and working in our hearts, renewing us, restoring us day by day, that we might reach out to renew and restore this world. So God, be with us, open our eyes and our hearts as we are mindful of those that we have lifted in prayer this morning, those that are struggling with health issues. We pray for your healing touch. We pray you be with those who are bringing healing. For those who are struggling in life, we just pray that you'll walk with them. For those that have been the victims of a violent crime, we pray that they will feel a sense of comfort and a sense of peace. Surround them with people who bring them safety and security to help bring them healing and wholeness and to put their lives back together. We pray, oh God, for those who are broken this day by poverty or violence or homelessness. And we lift in prayer all those who hear the call, who feel the nudge to go forward and to help make the kingdom a reality, to pray for it and to live it out through our faith. For, oh God, we are a blessed people, blessed with family and with friends who walk with us and journey with us. We are blessed with our relationship with Jesus Christ that gives us the strength and the energy of our faith that sees us through. Oh Lord, as we come this day, we lift to you these prayers of joy, these prayers of concern, and we lift them to you. But there are other prayers on our hearts, and so we pause for a moment just to open our hearts and let your Holy Spirit move through us in this time of silent prayer. Oh God, as you've heard our prayers, both silent and spoken, hear us as we join in prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A few announcements. All right. First of all, no high school, no youth choir tonight, but sanctuary choir. is at 7. Lunch Punch still going on Tuesdays with our study. Next Sunday is a busy Sunday. Next Sunday is Worldwide Communion. It's also Bread Sunday, so bring your bread and muffins and whatever else you want to bake and bring it, and it all gets sold. It goes to Hunger Task Force. The parish nurses are doing blood pressure checks, and they're doing the flu and pneumonia clinic right after church to get your shots. And we have our glass with glaze crafting workshop, which there's a table out by where the coffee is in the narthex out there. Sign up, pick out your pieces. There'll be other additional pieces there next Sunday. So that starts at 4, and then we have dinner for everybody at 5:30. So come on out for that. Also, the crop walk. This year, we're going to do the crop walk in Milwaukee on October 12th. So it's on a Sunday. Registration's at 12:30 at McKinley Park. It says sign up next Sunday, but you don't need to. See Marilyn Swissler. She's got a packet, and you can sign up today if you want. Also, remember the prayer breakfasts are this week, the women on Wednesday, the men on Thursday at 7. So come start your month out with a simple meal and a devotion and prayer and communion. So, yes, Linda. Oh, that's right. Yeah, so this Saturday from 9 to noon, this Saturday will be the Marshmallow Work Day. So come on out for that. And so that's this Saturday at 9 a.m. Thank you, Linda. Anything else I may have omitted? All right. Well, with all that, let us, with open hands and hearts, give back to God. We'll invite our ushers forward and our men's choir up.
Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Hush, somebody's calling my name. Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Oh, my Lord, oh, my Lord, what shall I do? I'm so glad that troubled oak are still ways. I'm so glad that troubled oak last always. I'm so glad that troubled oak last always. Oh, my Lord, oh, my Lord, what shall I do? Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Hush, somebody's calling my name. Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Oh, my Lord, oh, my Lord, what shall I do? I'm so glad I got my religion in time. I'm so glad I got my religion in time. I'm so glad I got my religion in time. Oh, my Lord, oh, my Lord, what shall I do? Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Hush, somebody's calling my name. Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Oh, my Lord, oh, my Lord, what shall I do? Soon on morning, Sunday in my room. Soon one morning, death come creeping in my room. Soon one morning, death come creeping in my room. Oh, my Lord, what shall I do? Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Hush, somebody's calling my name. Somebody's calling my name. Oh, my Lord, oh, my Lord, what shall I do? Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Hush, somebody's calling my name. Hush, hush, somebody's calling my name. Oh, my Lord, oh, my Lord, what shall I do?
Let's pray. Oh God, for all of these gifts, for all the ways that we continue to reach out, and for all of these blessings that we've shared this morning, we pray for them, and that you be with us as we continue to be renewed and be restored, that we may reach out to renew and restore this world in your name, by your love, by your grace and hope. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's join in our final hymn. We are all one in mission. 2243. Invite us for our benediction to hear that from our men's choir.